this week was probably 2013 or 14. What was that, Chris? 2013? Yeah, for the Craney Island Bicentennial with Chris and Steve Forrest, when we did our presentation on three veterans sitting around talking about what had happened at Craney Island. Of course, I got to be the Brit because I was the only one with a red coat. But yes, it feels strange to be in front of you in civvies, because normally I'm in early 19th century apparel when I do these presentations. So because Ocean View's centennial is not until later in the 20th century, it's inappropriate to be wearing my red coat for that. However, so here we are. Hang on. We've got a lot to cover, as you can see. There's 300 years of history for Freemasonry in Virginia. We've got 100 years for Ocean View itself. So don't consider this, please, to be a complete presentation by any means at all. This is just a taste of things, to let you know certain highlights and how things went. And then I want to end by looking at where Ocean View Lodge is today. Some dates for you. One of the things that I find fascinating about this is in 1717, the Premier Grand Lodge of England was formed by four lodges there who decided they needed for governance purposes an overarching body to run things. A mere 15 years later, the first lodge in Virginia is opened in downtown Norfolk called the Royal Exchange. And the fact of the matter is that this is a relatively short period of time, but it demonstrates Norfolk's position in the British Empire. So stop and think about this. Because of our deep water port here, we were very, very important for a lot of things. We were a transshipment point. We were a place where communication happened. Therefore, that's why a mere 15 years after the first one opened, which, you know, think, as Picky was saying, Freemasonry had been around in Europe and England for centuries already. Not quite in the form it is today, but nevertheless, only 15 years to get here. So it's chartered in 1733. There's a second lodge here. There's often some confusion. People will say, well, the Royal Exchange is just another name for St. John's. No, because St. John's was chartered by a completely entirely different national lodge, the Grand Lodge of Scotland. And we're going to talk about things like this a little bit more as we progress, because this makes a big difference as to what goes on. In 1751, we have the formation of the Ancient Grand Lodge of England. This is a very interesting little twist of language here, and it's kind of counterintuitive. But there were five Irish lodges in England that were practicing Freemasonry and went to the Grand Lodge, as it was then, the Premier Grand Lodge, and said, you're not practicing your Masonry correctly. You're missing the ancient parts of Freemasonry. While the Premier Grand Lodge wouldn't listen, so the ancients split off and formed their own Grand Lodge. And here's where the interesting twist comes in. They become known as the Ancients, even though they're the New Lodge. The Old Lodge is known as the Moderns, because they're using modern techniques in Freemasonry, which they don't appreciate. So in 1776, this is just in there because the research of all this stuff is very difficult, because the early records of Freemasonry in Norfolk and Virginia were lost with the bombardment of Norfolk in 1776. So we don't have the records at all from 1732, actually, to 1789. So we have to do the best we can in that time period with piecing things together. Some people have gone to England to try and find that and haven't had much success. We do what we can. It's a difficult thing to research. But in 1777 and 78, we then have the process of establishing the Grand Lodge of Virginia. Now, the reason we have to have a Grand Lodge here is because the war is on. We're going to be a separate country. We're no longer beholden to either the Grand Lodge of Scotland or the Grand Lodge of England. And a different tack was taken in the United States, where the individual colonies had their own Grand Lodges. So, you know, you will hear people talk about states' rights. You'll hear Lee, for example, when he's offered command of the Northern armies, says, no, Virginia is my country, where their state, actually a colony, did feel very much that way to them. So they had their own Grand Lodge. Matthew Fripp chairs the first meeting. Now, poor Matthew Fripp has a very ill father in Williamsburg. He goes to visit him, and while he's on his way, he is forced to sign a pledge of allegiance to the Brits, and is, when he comes back to Norfolk, is put under house arrest for treachery, even though he at one time chaired the Committee of Safety. So he's not going anywhere. So throughout 1777, 1778, it is actually James Taylor, Dr. James Taylor, who, by the way, for those of you who are interested in medical history, is very interesting in his work in the smallpox epidemic, and he was his house was almost burned down because people did not like the idea of inoculation. So James Taylor is interred in the cemetery at St. Paul's. If you go there, you'll see the square and compasses on his tombstone. He was the first Grand Senior Warden. That would make him number three in line. You had the Grand Master of Masons, the Deputy Grand Master of Masons, and then the Grand Senior Warden, Grand Junior Warden, and so on. But they stayed on it for 6 years to determine how Freemasonry would be practiced in Virginia. And they decided that it would be practiced in the ancient manner. So all of our lodges are followed by the initials AF and AM, Ancient, Free, and Accepted Masons. The ancient and is that affiliation we talked about earlier. Free is free to work. It's more of a term for operative masons. It'd be free stonemasons, free to work as it could in the guild. Accepted meant that they were actually speculative masons, not operative masons. So ancient, free, and accepted masons is what we have in Virginia. Ocean View Lodge, Lodge number 335, ancient, free, and accepted masons. When in the process of setting this all up, they recognized Norfolk as the founding area for Freemasonry in Virginia by giving our lodge here the number one, which still exists today. Norfolk Lodge number one meets at the Granby Street Temple. There we are. Now here's the second site. The Royal Exchange met downtown. We're not exactly sure where. The second site is now the site of the Willoughby Biller House. Now it was not like that. That house was built after the sale in 1791. I believe it was built in 1794. But that's the second location where Masons met in Norfolk. 1791 is also a banner year for Norfolk in that Thomas Matthews becomes the first Grand Master of Masons in Virginia from Norfolk. He's an amazing man. He's the Speaker of the House of Delegates. He is eventually becomes a judge. He becomes the, in 1799, the Brigadier General commanding the Norfolk military area. A really outstanding individual. Now, you can find out a lot more about Thomas Matthews and other early Masons and what we're going to do now. So this is a link to the other presentation I did. Quick. I think the sounds up there is pretty good. I just need to put the microphone up closer to it, I think.
And for Norfolk. And from that point of view, I started to take a look at what I already knew about the War of 1812 and the significance of Fort Norfolk.
So there you are. We have an existing video that talks a lot about the early Masons in Norfolk. And I would advise you to go in the relationship that there were between other places as well. So for example, Thomas Matthews was a great friend of the man who would become President, James Monroe, who was Governor Monroe in 1799 when Matthews was appointed as the general commanding in the Norfolk military area. In 1819, during his first term in office, James Monroe comes to Norfolk to lay the cornerstone of the Customs Building, which is now the site of the World Trade Center down on Main Street. I tell you these things to show you all the Masons that are coming and going in Norfolk, so that you understand what, why things built the way they did in Ocean View. So things that happened in 1751, in 1791, in 1819, all affect what's going to happen in 1921. Now, this is where the third location is, and I don't know if you can see this right here. Can you see where it says Freemason Street? There. If you go up here, you see the number 28. That is the 19th century Masonic Hall in Norfolk. That is where the Marquis de Lafayette will come in 1824 when he attends Norfolk Lodge number 1 at the corner of Bank and Freemason Streets. In their records, they have his signature for attending Lodge. He and his son, George Washington Lafayette, and his aide-de-camp, all three of them went to Lodge there. One of the interesting things about the Marquis de Lafayette is, once again, a great friend of Monroe's, but a very early abolitionist. He had a plantation in French Guiana where he grew cinnamon and cloves and freed his workforce and paid them and made a profit. And the notion has always been that the South in its economic system required slavery. And he showed very clearly that it was not a requirement, that it could be done without that. And here's the interesting thing, because when you have the French Revolution, Napoleon takes over and all the rest of it with liberté, fraternité, égalité, they re-enslave the workforce at his plantation. They put them back into chains, back into slavery. So much for égalité. There we are, the Marquis de Lafayette in 1824. Moving along, and I'm sorry to have to flip through quickly like this, but just to give you an idea, things are happening fairly quickly. So in 1854, Atlantic Lodge number 2 is formed. William Mahone, who is in the president of the Norfolk and Petersburg Railroad, lays out the streets for Ocean View, but the Civil War intervenes and they're not able to finish all the work in Ocean View, so that stops. It goes up again in 1879, when Mahone, who by this time, after being a brigadier general in the Confederate Army and commanding at the Battle of the Crater in Petersburg, has, walked the road to Damascus or something, because he forms the Readjustment Party, which is an interracial party, to try and get the state of Virginia back in the hands of Virginians and away from the federal government. So he figures that if we do this, we can readjust, we can go back to being the state that we were, minus slavery. So, in doing the Norfolk and Ocean View Railroad, which is a small gauge railroad that runs from downtown Norfolk up to Ocean View, the president is William H. Taylor, Robert E. Lee's former aide-de-camp, and the man who wrote several books, too, I think, at least, explaining the Confederacy as the famous lost cause. This is the man that does that. So once again, we have a sort of a contradiction here, the Readjustment Party on the one hand, William H. Taylor on the other, but they move forward in the development of Ocean View. So both Taylor and Mahone knew Robert Flint Owens, who was the third Grand Master Mason from Norfolk, 1870-71. His lodge is named after him, was formed in 1867, so things are moving along. On the left here, we have he's known as Little Billy Mahone, because he's a very short man, short and thin, before the Civil War, during the Civil War, and after. The tombstone of Grand Master Thomas Owens is right there, and also the membership certificate for the Masonic Mutual Beneficial Association for William H. Taylor in 1877. Once again, Masons are walking around doing stuff. This time we're not talking about, we're no longer talking about Norfolk in general, we're talking specifically about Ocean View. So the lodges keep forming in Norfolk. There's a lot of activity, a lot of interest here. By the time we get to 1899, Ocean View is recognized as a resort area. And there's by 1905, we have a cottage real estate association that is selling off property. So there's another good reason for the Norfolk and Ocean View Railroad, so people can come up here, be by the bay, and enjoy themselves considerably. Now, you have to bear in mind, in 1907, the tricentennial celebration of the Jamestown expedition, there is no Jamestown as there is now. There's neither what has been set up and run by the state now, nor is there the Jamestown proper. So Norfolk begins to agitate to get the Jamestown celebration here, and they succeed. And it's opened on April 27, 1907, by President Theodore Roosevelt, Teddy Roosevelt, another Mason from Oyster Bay Lodge in New York. This is the man that brings us a lot of the phrases that we use today. Square deal, square meal, on the level. So yes, President Roosevelt is down here, it is opened up, and what happens is the place that is now the Naval Station Norfolk is where the exhibition site is. At the same time, the amusement park opens, and that includes a lot of information. There's your exhibition. The hotel was part of the amusement park, so you can come down here and stay at the hotel in Ocean View. Ocean View is growing exponentially, it's doing very well. It comes to be known as the Coney Island of the South. It was a favorite place for conventions. You know, your members could stay in the cottages, and you would have a meeting in the hall and so on. Wonderful place to be, relaxing, the bay was right there, and in fact, it gets its name, of course, from the sand dunes that were there, where you could walk up to the top of them and see the ocean. Atlantic Ocean. So it wasn't just being able to see Chesapeake Bay, you could actually see the ocean and Virginia Beach and so on, so hence the name Ocean View. The newest thing that happens, of course, at that time is the establishment of Naval Station Norfolk in 1917. This is critical, of course, because that's the same year that we enter World War I. Ships leave from there, things happen there. The site of the exhibition, Jamestown celebration, is simply taken over. The finest buildings become things like the administration building, because the states were all asked to build a building that represented their states. There are lots of really nice construction there. And there's a whole area that's known as Admiral's Row, which is actually the site of the Jamestown celebration. Still there, yes. Yeah. Now, as we're moving up to the time where Ocean View Lodge is formed, I want you to understand the environment that it came out of. 1918, 1919, we have some very, very serious epidemics which are worldwide and present in North America. There's a worldwide epidemic of encephalitis in 1918, which is, they believe, is transferred by mosquitoes. Affects the brain, people go, there's not a lot of information on cases here in the Norfolk area or Hampton Roads at all. There is a lot of information on the Spanish influenza epidemic, which we thought was brought back by returning veterans from Europe. As you can see, they're really impacted here dramatically. 9,000 cases in Norfolk resulting in 1,000 deaths. So it makes the pandemic look like a walk in the park. And you have to remember as well, we did not have the same public health facilities then as we do now. They were not as able to respond to it. 1919 was also referred to as the Red Summer, not because of the Bolshevik Revolution in 1917 or the Russians coming around, but because there were some 38 race riots. The Red Summer refers to the bloodshed that summer between the races. In Norfolk, there was a celebration planned for July 21st, 1919, of returning African American veterans. The Norfolk police said there was an altercation between the African Americans themselves. They then went in and tried to break it up. But we're not talking about the same group anymore. The African Americans are not prepared to roll over and play dead. No. They know their way around small arms now. They've been trained. They can fight. This is a new situation entirely. So they have to call in the shore police from the naval station and also the military police from the Marines. So this is not a happy time at all. 1920-21. Okay, we have Prohibition, the Volstead Act. Billy Sunday is a noted preacher who is also a temperance man, no question about it. He comes and speaks on that very day here in Norfolk on the evils of alcohol. We have an economic depression from January 1920 through to July 1921. So once again, the environment out of which Ocean View Lodge number 335 comes out of is not an easy situation. In spring of 1920, we have 46 Masons that are from the Ocean View area that get together to talk about forming a lodge. 33 of that number petition the Grand Lodge of Virginia to have this happen. Now, what's the reason for this? These men live in Ocean. The roads here are so horrific, they can't get easily back into Norfolk to go to the lodges there. So the transportation problems in southeastern Virginia is not new. It goes back at least as far as 1920. So that's why it was formed, to be a community lodge for those men who lived here so that they could easily meet. So on September 4th, 1920, the Grand Master issued a dispensation calling for the new lodge to meet some 11 days later. This is Most Worshipful Gulf. So the lodge is created through dispensation. They say, you don't exist right now, you don't have a charter, but we're going to let you meet. So at the Grand Lodge State of Communication, annual communication, which is just another way of saying an annual meeting, the charter is issued and the game's afoot. We now have Ocean View Lodge. I'm going to show you some of the early masters of the lodge. You should know the first three are civilian employees of Naval Station Norfolk. This again is something important to know because to this day, we have a very tight relationship with that facility. So, Most Worshipful Baltimore is the one who actually signs the charter and puts it out there. If you look there, down the bottom right, it says where we were 1921 to 1925. If you go to the Ocean View Plaza and come down back by McDonald's and go out the entrance onto Aview Street, you'll see a building right dead ahead of you, which is a two-story building. And in 1921, the first floor was the Ocean View Post Office, the second floor was Ocean View Lodge. Later on in 1925, when the building was built that we currently use today, that's on Bellevue, one block behind, and further down more towards First View. Now, one of the things I want you to understand is I know that most people in this room can read. I'm not going to read these slides to you. I'm going to highlight again. So this is Worshipful Master Bernard Francis Porter. A very interesting man. He is the first three masters. Not only are they employees of Naval Station Norfolk, they never held office in the Masonic Lodge before. They were gone through their degrees, done all the work they had to do, but they had not held an office before. So this is breaking new ground for them. And the fact that they were willing to do that is an indication of their dedication. Master number two, Henry Daniel Hood. Once again, also from Elizabeth Lodge number 34, where the first one was from. He lived on Coleman Avenue. I live on Rappard Avenue, which is like two blocks over from Coleman. If you were both living today, he would be my neighbor. So yes, obviously people who were living in Ocean View who wanted to be in that lodge, very close to that site there. But remember, we're not talking about vehicles that could go 30 miles an hour. You're talking about, you know, revved up versions of the Model T and so on. Frank Shoemaker, a civil service supervisor. So once again, same thing, Naval Station Norfolk. Here we go. Wilbur Thornton, master in 1924. This man was very active in the lodge throughout his life. He's there right through to 1942. He also became Ocean View's first district deputy grandmaster, who was the representative of a grandmaster in a district. Norfolk is District 35. At that time, there were seven lodges in District 35. I believe there's nine today. But what would happen is every 7 years, they would rotate around. So the first time we get to 7 years for Ocean View, he's in 1928, from 1921 to 1928. So that shows the support that the other lodges had for Ocean View as well. There was no discussion. It's simply your turn. You're one of us. It's your turn. Now, Archie Tolan is also another interesting man. He was the master when the building went up. All of these men all worked to get the building put together so that we could continue to have meetings. Remember, when you're talking about the second floor of the building that they were in to begin with, you don't have a lot of room to work with. So it's difficult to do things like have meals and do that and all the rest and still do your ritual work in the lodge. So the officers of Ruth Lodge, number 89, assisted greatly in putting the lodge up. And there you can see, I apologize for the color of the picture, but that's the Masonic ceremony of the cornerstone laying for the lodge. And it looked then as it does now. Now the plans for this lodge were also used to build another lodge in Chesapeake. South Norfolk Lodge is identical. It went up at the same time, perhaps a year or two later. The Masonic Home of Virginia is very interesting as well in what they did with this. This turned out not as an adult care facility as it is today. Long-term care facility. No, it was an orphanage. Now, to be a Masonic orphan, all that has to happen is the Mason has to die. So if your father picks his cloud and goes to heaven, you are immediately a Masonic orphan. And it is the job of Masons to make sure that you are looked after. One of them are charged with providing relief to Masonic widows and orphans. So every year, there were a busload of children from the Masonic Home in Richmond, bring them down to Ocean View to be able to go to the amusement park, and Ocean View Lodge hosted them. This is a big part of what we did. So this was part of our service to the Masonic community. we go through, you know, trying to do the research on the history of this organization was difficult because the minutes of Ocean View Lodge are very perfunctory. We met, we did this, we did that. The meeting was over at 8:30, good night. So how are we gonna find out what happened, what opinions were, who spoke, who the visitors were, and so on? Lots of research required. Another Mason and I went through the minutes in detail, and I mean in detail, word by word, for the early 1940s to see if we could find the war dead. No one was mentioned. Now, the remembering of our dead is a big thing for Masons. We do that when someone dies, we take a page in the minutes and record when they were initiated, all the things that they did and so on. Nothing whatsoever for World War II. So whether that was for security reasons, we just couldn't figure out why, but there was nothing there. So this was not a good source. So we then said, okay, in terms of trying to figure out the history of our lodge, we're going to have to say, we're going to look at what our members would have seen. So what was the history of Norfolk, the history of Virginia, and the history of the United States that would have affected them as they were going through? So of course the Roaring Twenties is part of that. And in the 1920s, remember we were talking earlier about the race riots, there was a resurgence of the Ku Klux Klan. The chapter in Norfolk is called the Albert Pike Chapter. Albert Pike, P-I-K-E. Albert Pike was a general in the Confederate Army. He was also a noted 19th century Mason. So the choice of that name for that chapter, it's easy to infer that there would have been Masons involved in that. I mean, to our shame, to our lasting shame, yes, but I think you could say that. Whether there were members of Ocean View there or not, I don't know. But that was the kind of attitude that you had at that time. The Depression was very interesting. They actually paid off the building by 1941. They kept paying through the Depression. Imagine how the building entirely paid off. Of course, in World War II, we have the growth of Naval Station Norfolk, to the point where, in order to make more room, they load up trucks with the sand dunes from Ocean View. There is no more Ocean View, 1941. It's taken over to Willoughby Bay and put in to make the Naval Station larger with more usable space. In 1952, we have this wonderful thing going on for Ocean View. We are the eighth largest in terms of numbers Masonic Lodge in the state. 746 men, 746 members. I think today we have approximately 150. When the Granby Street Temple opened up, you've all probably seen that on Granby Street, in 1954, our building was a mere 29 years old. So why would we go anywhere else? That's one thing. What that did was, by not moving into the Granby Street Temple, Ocean View maintained its own identity. And it's always had that tight connection to the community of Ocean View. By the way, just going back a little bit, Ocean View was annexed by the city of Norfolk in 1923. So if we look at this and say, okay, 1921, we have the Ocean View Masonic Lodge form. It may have been one of the last true Ocean View organizations before simply being a neighborhood in Norfolk. So you'll see Ocean View this, Ocean View that. That's just identified in terms of the neighborhood that they're in. No, this really was part of Ocean View. We also lived through other things that would go on. Massive resistance, segregation, Vietnam through the 50s and 60s. Now, you all know about massive resistance, right? When the school shut down rather than integrate. So we also have, not here so much, but in lots of places across the country, protests and so on for the Vietnam War, a lot of negative treatment of veterans by the public. Our reactions in Ocean View to this kind of stuff are not like that at all. Not at that time, not this time. Ocean View is very different. And right now we become more different than most in that we became one of the first lodges in Virginia to accept African-American members. We, in the year following our centennial, 2022, the master of the lodge was African-American. The district deputy grand master, was our attorney, was Afro-Caribbean. These things could not have happened in earlier times, but they do now. We would never consider things like disrespecting our veterans. Remember we talked about the close tie with Naval Station Norfolk. It's not just that. We have Army veterans. We have Marine veterans, we have lots of veterans. But more than that, we, all of us, have a deep and abiding respect for our military and for our veterans. So no, you wouldn't have found that. We might not have agreed with Vietnam, the reasons for going there and doing what we did, but we would not have taken that out on the veterans. Absolutely not. The 1970s. We have our 50th anniversary in 1971. So hard to believe that was 50 years ago. A little more. The amusement park was torn down in 1972. They had to use dynamite to get rid of the roller coaster ride. So, sorry? That's the information I have. So we'll talk about that afterwards, no problem. 1974, continuing on with the political problems of the Vietnam era, you have the resignation of Richard Nixon. And the first unelected president of the United States takes office. He's been Speaker of the House of Representatives, Gerald Ford, who was the last Mason to hold the highest office in the land. There hasn't been another Mason as president since. So this is, these are things that all of our members are seeing. There's a familiar face. Some of the things that we do today, we recognize people in the community. And one of the ways we do that is with the Community Builders Award. In this particular instance, you're looking at our very own Chris Mantuish, who was given that award for his work on the Bicentennial of Coney Island and for his work with the USS Constitution. You can tell you a lot more about that. Peggy Halvin Phillips has also been honored with the Community Builders Award. Steve Forrest and Rob Fry were given Community Builders Awards by Norfolk Lodge No. 1. So we do this routinely, and you can see we have a deep and abiding respect for history as well. Because not every lodge looks at those kinds of things and says this is important to our community, but we do. Our members worked on the Coney Island Bicentennial Committee, individually, not as representing the lodge, but on the left there is a presentation that was done at the Grand Lodge Library and Museum to show the rest of the Masons in Virginia just what was going on in Norfolk. And the mural that you see there was painted by Sam Welty in Portsmouth, which shows the battle very clearly, a really, really nice job. But we love to be involved in community events like this. We're involved every year. We attend the MacArthur Memorial's wreath-laying ceremony for our brother in general, Douglas MacArthur, who was also a Mason. And so there's our group from last year, I think. But we do that every year. We come here specifically to recognize our brother Mason who's laid to rest, and given the importance of brother MacArthur, we think this is a very, very suitable thing for us to do, to be involved in. Blood drives, twice a year at least. Lots of other lodges do this as well. This is something that the Masonic lodges are known for throughout Virginia. But at Ocean, we take great pride in making sure that we get the greatest number of units in every single time. It's a matter of pride for us to do the best we can to help others. Food bank donations, the Norfolk Food Bank. We make sure we have got those contributions looked after, because it's, you can't talk about thinking about, you know, relief and charity and all those kinds of things when people aren't even eating. What kind of a world is that when people aren't even eating? So our relief and charity extends there too. We have a small building, a small lodge. We don't often get the Grand Master to come to visit us, but sometimes they do. This is a photograph from 2016 when the Grand Lodge, the Grand Master came down to visit us. Every year we have an annual family picnic. Family activities are important to us. We don't get a chance to do that enough, because our wives and children are very, very important. If you are applying to be a Freemason in Virginia, several things will happen. One of which is a visitation. Three Masons on the visitation committee will come to visit you. If you are married, they will ask your wife how she feels about this. If she's not interested in you being a Mason, we will suggest to you that perhaps you might want to think about this a little further and come back to us again later. Because the lodge is not there to come between man and wife, husband and wife. Not at all, no. Family is very, very, very important. So every year, we have things that we try and invite our families in, and every year we make sure that we have at least one family picnic for everybody involved. That gentleman on the right, his name is Dan Sparks. His father and uncle were Masonic orphans at the Masonic Home of Virginia. His mother later went into adult care and died at the Masonic Home. So, I mean, we have a very tight connection there as well. We routinely beat out other lodges and our contributions to the Masonic Home of Virginia to make sure that our elders are looked after. Before that, of course, it was orphans, now it's elders. We have other activities that people are involved in, other Masonic bodies. These are often referred to as the appendant bodies. The Scottish Rite is one where we have the advanced degrees. So in what they refer to as the Blue Log Lodge or Speculative Lodge, you have the first 3 degrees of Masonry. So to make it that far, you've heard the term to get the third degree? That's where it comes from. Okay, the Scottish Rite goes from the fourth degree to the 32nd degree with an honorary 33rd degree as well. On the left there, we have a member who's a motion who was also a Scottish Rite Mason giving an award at the Navy ROTC ceremony at ODU. On the right, we have the program from the Norfolk Scottish Rite Celebrity Gala, which is put on every year to help with speech pathology at ODU. Speech pathology is a named area of funding for the Scottish Rite. And our members from ODU are in there doing that. We used to go into the St. Patrick's Day as a lodge, but we found that as more people got involved with different parts of Masonry, they went with other things as well. So here we have Ocean View members who are also members of the Shrine Club. And we have on the far left there the motorcycle unit. The man in the center of the middle picture there is our member, the other two are not. And then we have the gentleman that I was telling you who was the master of the lodge in 2021 in the miniature 18-wheelers. But so we have a presence in the St. Patrick's Day Parade, just not officially as Ocean View Lodge. We're often referred to as the Kilted Lodge. Many of our members enjoy doing this. That's how we get dressed up. That's how we are identifiable. So yeah, it's an interesting part. I personally don't wear that. Like I said, I'm more comfortable in early 19th century clothes than I am those sorts of things. I suppose our kilts in 1812 as well. But I just like what I have to wear there. Okay, now I'm going to show you something here in a second, which is Ocean View Lodge marching in a parade which was national, the centennial of the cornerstone name for the George Washington Masonic National Memorial in Alexandria. There were Masons from literally across the country at this parade. Now, I can see how if you're traveling from Alaska, perhaps you wouldn't be able to get 10 or 15 guys to go along with that. It's expensive and all the rest of it. But we had about that number, about 15 members that went up there. And I think driving up to Alexandria is more of a trial than flying, but that's okay. It was very nicely done. Now, something else I want to talk to you about, and I'm going to ask Dr. Warren Stewart to come up here and tell you a little story about his family in Ocean View Lodge.
In 1948, I was 2. My father, who was a Mason, passed away. The Ocean View Lodge Masons, my mother told me and reminded me almost daily, were it not for them, we would not have lived on very easily. Women, ladies, in 1948 could not easily find work. So for at least the first year after my father passed away, we existed because of the Ocean View Lodge. Now, my father was a Mason, but he was in the Elizabeth Lodge. So as I completed my learning, undergraduate school, master's, and doctorate, then I took on my learning in Masonry. And a gentleman who was 99 years old began providing me enlightenment. And as a result of that, I became a Master Mason, later a Scottish Rite, a Shrine Club president, and so forth. I'm a lifetime member in perpetuity in the Ocean View Lodge, and I am grateful to the Ocean View Lodge for life and for learning. I'm continuing to learn. Grateful to be here. Thank you, sir.
This is an example, and I'm glad that one was able to share that with us, of what happens, and what we do. Remember I said that we were obliged to support and provide relief for Masonic widows and orphans, and that's an example of how we did that. Okay, finally, we're getting towards the end here, folks. We're just about done. As Peggy was telling you, the pandemic interrupted our celebration of our lodge centennial, the formation of the lodge. And we looked at this and said, you know what? We're not going to let that spoil our celebration. So what we're going to do is recognize as well the centennial of the building in 2025, and we will declare those years to be our heritage years. And we will work, because we couldn't get the book finished, we were working on it because, of course, during the pandemic, museums and libraries closed down. The research was not possible. So we said, we've got two more years to do this in. Let's do that. Let's make sure we can get that going. And that's what we're working on right now. Now, I have a little thing I want to tell you about. This is our statement on where we come from and who we are, which was prepared as part of the research for the book. The question of at what point in time did events conspire to create the entity now known as Oceanview Lodge has an answer that is both terribly complicated and extremely simple. We participate in all of the developments, successes, and failures of speculative masonry in England, in Virginia, or in Norfolk as our history progresses. That is the complicated and very layered answer. The simple answer is that Oceanview Lodge became possible in the beginning. In the beginning here is not a biblical phrase, just a point in time. We suggest that the point in time that Oceanview Lodge became possible is for our purposes 1751, for it was in that year that a group of five lodges composed of Irish Masons living in England told the Premier Grand Lodge of England that they, the Premier but not the first, Grand Lodge founded in 1717, had fallen away from the old ways and were not properly practicing speculative masonry. Thus, in a counterintuitive bit of language, those following the old ways became a new Grand Lodge in England and were known as the Ancients, and the earlier Grand Lodge became known as the Moderns, as I was saying before. One of the substantial differences is that in its beginnings, the Ancients had among their members not one single aristocrat, whereas the Moderns had many, many, and included members of the English royal family. Just 25 years after the Ancients came into being, the Declaration of Independence was signed by the representatives of the original 13 colonies that together would form the United States of America. A mere 2 years later, the Grand Lodge of Virginia was formed, and the first Grand Line remained in office for a period of 6 years while decisions were made about how Freemasonry would be practiced in this state. The decision was made that Virginia Freemasonry would be ancient, free, and accepted Masons. Not all Grand Lodges in all original states made this decision. Some did, but others chose to be free and accepted Masons in the legacy of the Moderns. It is said of Worshipful Brother and President George Washington that he refused to attend lodge in any lodge practice running on working in the Moderns fashion. The secretary of the Ancients Grand Lodge in 1756, Brother Lawrence Dermot, brought forward the Ahalan Rizon, the Ancients Book of Constitutions. It was no surprise when in 1791, Thomas Matthews, the first Grand Master from Norfolk, introduced the new Ahalan Rizon to guide Virginia Masons. So we're staying very clearly with the Ancients' progress in the way that they do things. Oceanview Lodge is a community of brethren amongst whom one would not find even one aristocrat. The wisdom of the Grand Line, although perhaps not readily visible in its founding, led to the creation of lodges like Oceanview, working in the old ways, now 21st century Ancients. From the Masonic journeys of Worshipful Brother George Washington and Brother James Monroe led them both to the highest civilian office in the land. In their presidencies, we may see the kind of service to which all good Masons strive and in which we as Virginia Masons have models to emulate. Brother Monroe, elected as president in 1816, was returned to office in 1820 through what was really acclamation because no one ran against him. An elector from New Hampshire threw his vote to one who was not even on the ballot so that Worshipful Brother Washington alone would have the honor of acclamation. He, Brother Monroe, had run unopposed in the 1820 election because the Federalist Party was in tatters. And in his second inaugural speech given early in 1821, at a time when he could have attacked the electorate that deprived him of clear reclamation, who would logo the demise of his political adversaries, Brother Monroe said words to the effect that unity had overtaken the country, and that while he was not the cause of that unity, he was its instrument. It is no wonder that Brother Monroe's two terms as president of the United States came to be known as the era of good feelings. A remarkable thing indeed for a politician not to take credit for something that could have worked to his advantage. Even more so, to accept only the mantle of instrumentality. Here's another Virginia Masonic example of how Ocean View Lodge works. We are not the causes of charity or truth or brotherly love or any of the myriad of the positive Masonic principles upon which we seek to base our lives, but we are their instruments. The fact that it was said 100 years before our establishment shows how events conspired to make Ocean View Lodge what it is today. This is where we come from. To finish off, ladies and gentlemen, I want to talk about who we are. Ocean View Lodge number 335, as its history shows, developed and changed over 100 years of existence from a community lodge that came together reflecting Virginia Masonry as it was in 1921 to the organization that stands today as a beacon of inclusion and equality. We seek good men with whom we may associate and lodge by the terms of our Master Mason's obligation, and further definition added by Grand Lodge edicts and definitions. We do not seek to exclude on the basis of non-essential qualities, characteristics, orientations, or origins. This lodge stresses now, as it always has, precision and education. This reflects the need to continuously improve in providing services to our members and the community. Education makes us precise. Being precise makes us want to improve even further. Yet the emphasis on these areas and activities that accompany them do not make us unapproachable. Whether kilted up for our own state of communication or to distinguish us when we visit other lodges, Ocean View Lodge is purposely identifiable. Ocean View Lodge number 335 is a unique entity in Virginia Masonry. The lodge went through its first 99 years without any master serving more than one term in the East. That's the direction that where the master sits. We had until recently an Eastern Star chapter and continue to have our Job's daughter, Bethel number 3, operating in Ocean View Lodge. In our membership are included Masons who have taken up advanced degrees in the ancient accepted Scottish Rite and York Rite. Participation in historical, community, and other events involving Masons in Norfolk, Hampton, Williamsburg, and Richmond is commonly undertaken. We are active and interested. As has been the case for the entire century of Ocean View's existence, we have a deep and close connection with the armed forces of the United States in general and with Naval Station Norfolk in particular. Those who, for a variety of reasons, have not had the opportunity to serve in a military capacity support our armed services personnel as much as our veterans do. We are patriotic. We are good men seeking to better ourselves in our Masonic journeys, not men considering ourselves to be better than anyone else. Inclusive, precise and educated, purposely identifiable, active and interested and patriotic. 21st century ancients working to create a new era of good feelings. This is who we are. Thank you.